keys, I'm the boss. Don't Griselda go off. Left from the loft and went to Bergdorf. Most of these dudes is really quite soft. 45 special, this is my cloth. About to drop an album, this is my fourth. I don't put sugar in my spaghetti sauce. Drop a freestyle and get these hoes perched.
Fire burn, it will be a mantra.
Just like with some odd girl out of road. Come and have the way a smile, pretty boss wine. Rolex and the panel and the girl tie.
Yeah. Oh, not links. I heard the screen recording. Like so
he call me queen, he know Nicki is the moniker. He wanna mix between Hillary and Monica. I switch it up. Rip the beat and I stitch it up. Traveled and I bounced up all Sinead, sir. Barbie, I link up Major Lazer.
I'm a renegade. I'm a runner,
I'm a runner, is there a way to make it not such a nasty bowler? Okay. So that shows you what's up here, and that shows you the next one.
Yeah.
making this stuff up before?
Yeah, I was slightly lying.
Stop them, dear. Stop them, dear. All that you came around.
time to pee or not? No? Quick.
A good girl, never want to be late, complain, express ideas in her brain. Working on the night shift, passing up the tickets, you're gonna have to pay her if you wanna park here. Well, mommy's little dancer is quite a little secret, walking on the streets now, never gonna keep. She's only wishing that she would have listened to the words they said. Poor Taylor, she just wanders around, unaffected by the winter winds, yeah. She'll pretend that she's somewhere else, so far and close, about 2,000 miles.
Okay, everyone. Welcome to our final of our interactive sessions. It's great to see everyone here. There's a big hole in the middle. If anyone feels like getting a bit of a better view, please feel free, like, coming forward. But otherwise, if you're comfy, go for it. Put your feet up, relax. Not too much to share. It's the last night, so nothing too exciting to report on. I'll give everyone a quick update on the plans for tonight, the most exciting part. And until then, I'll just introduce a real top guy, Drew, who's going to be talking to us all about crew resource management. So let's hear it for Drew.
No.
Is it?
No, no.
Yeah.
It is?
It is. Hello. Does anyone want to move forward? Anyone? Does anyone want to come across?
No.
No? Okay. I'm here to talk to you about something that the reason I put that up there is
The first two rows may get converted, but no one's actually sitting in the first two rows. So it might have to be more than that. I am a bit nervous, I'll give you that. Never done this before. Dylan gave me some great advice. He said, don't stress, dude. Picture everyone naked. And I said, I would, but my sister's sitting in the back row. So you're all safe. I'm not picturing anyone. So why am I here? Everyone has an origin story, I think, whether you know yours or not. As a kid, I loved watching a TV show called Air Crash Investigations. I just love seeing charred bodies. No. Actually, I liked it because more often than not, it was human factors that caused big planes to crash and lots of people to die. And what they did, they'd go back and investigate why and try and make sure it didn't happen again. And it wasn't until later in life I discovered that's why I like this sort of stuff. First of all, where's my clicker? Forgot, there it is. First of all, who am I? And why would you listen to me? Well, you don't have to if you don't want to, that's fine. Is there a, I thought you said a...
Yeah, you can hold the one.
Yeah, it's not working. Oh, that's a bit silly. I won't do that. I'm Drew, paramedic since 2009 till now. I then worked as a clinical support paramedic, which, unless you're from WA, you won't really know what that is, but I can explain it a little bit. Most recently, I've escaped the chaos by working as a community paramedic, and that was about 230 k's north of Kalgoorlie, if you know that. And so about 130 k's from help one way, or 230 k's from help the other way. Does anyone recognise anyone? Anyone? No? A very young Dylan and Quentin? I was Dylan's permanent partner for 2 years, and I lost 2 years of my life just coming to work and laughing all day. And then when he went job share, I said to him, what about me? So, Dylan said people like crashes, so I put some in there. So I spent about 3 years being a CSP, clinical support paramedic. And what that is you spend half your time working in an operation centre like that, answering phone calls for volunteers, for metro crews, for anyone and everyone, dispatching helicopters, doing things like that. So if you're not a good verbal communicator, you need to be one eventually. Men can't multitask. Well, actually, I've said that no one can multitask. It's just you do lots of stuff bad, but I learned how to multitask doing that. The rest of my time in a car that looks a lot like that, around 700 jobs over 3 years, and just so, I don't know, I'm not bragging, just a bit of perspective, about 700 jobs in 3 years, 130 of those were active resuscitations. So they're not people that I've rocked up to that have been dead, they've been CPR in progress. So over one in seven jobs you're doing is a resus. So you get very experienced at doing that. So that's where I learned all my stuff. Well, that's where I think I learned all my stuff. And then the final one here is that's me sitting on a hill in Leonora. And that's when I got to consolidate everything. And I spent 6 months out there. And shortly before that, Dylan asked me to do a speech on something. He knew I was a bit of a human factors nerd. And I said, if you think people want to listen, I'll have a chat. But that's where I got to put all this together. So, step one, why are you here? I want to take you back to 1978. I want to ask who was born in 1978, but I think people might get angry. John and Olivia were in the movies, Grease. Staying Alive was number one, had been for a while. I don't know if they realised it would become synonymous with CPR, that song, but... And flight attendants apparently showed a lot more leg. Before 1945, before World War II, every flight attendant had to be a nurse, believe it or not. Also,
United Airlines have just bought a brand new McDonnell Douglas DC-8, about $100 million in today's money. And they said, this is a big aircraft, expensive aircraft. We can't just let anyone fly it around. It's gonna be a flagship. Who are we gonna get? We're gonna get Buddy McBroom. Everyone in the 70s had a nickname. I think it was from being in the Air Force, but anyway. So Buddy, 600 hours of flight time. Then he had Rod, 5,200, and Frosty. I like Frosty the best. Altogether, 36,700 hours of flight time between them. So to put that in perspective, it's flying a plane continuously for 4 years. Or if you like to sleep, if you want to do 12-hour shifts, it'd be 12 and 12 for 8 years. It's a long time. You know why they picked these people. So what happened? Well, Buddy and the crew took a plane up on December 28, 1978. Denver to Portland, it's meant to be an easy flight, easy weather, 189 people on board, and they had enough fuel plus 45 minutes. And that was normal back then, that was a buffer. 45 minutes was their normal buffer. Shortly before they come in to start their approach, they lowered the landing gear and noticed a bit of a thump and some vibration. They also didn't have a green light saying their landing gear had been lowered. So what did they do? They told air traffic control, give us a holding pattern. We're going to try and diagnose this problem. And that's what they spent the next hour doing. Can anyone see a problem? So 50 minutes later, Rod, the flight engineer, because there was three people in the planes back then, he's heard saying things such as, ooh, not enough, or that'll run us pretty close out here. But he never said, yo, we have no fuel. 5 minutes later, the pilot speaks to the cabin, the first and only time he speaks to the cabin, said, we're gonna be landing in 5 minutes. I'll let you know soon if you need to be in the brace position. So the cabin suddenly thought, what the fuck's going on? This is all fine, we're coming to land, now we've got to be in the brace position. He said, I'll let you know shortly, and he never let them know. 1803, finally tells, or air traffic control actually calls them, they didn't call him, and said, when are you going to start your approach? He says, I guess another 3, 4, 5 minutes. So again, not really saying much at all. What do you think happened next? 1806, engine flame out. One engine flamed out first, and the captain was so sure he had fuel, he's heard on the voice recorder yelling at the flight engineer, saying to transfer fuel from one to the other, because there's no way he could be out of fuel. So he still doesn't understand the gravity. And then the second one flames out, and he says, oh, okay. Declares a mayday, shortly after they make a crash landing. I wanted a pointer, but it's not really going to work. Anyway, they crashed here and the airport's there. So it was about 10Ks. They luckily landed in a field, but narrowly missed an apartment block. So it could have been worse. Now, luckily or unluckily, whatever you want to say, only 10 people died. And I'll say only because there's a lot of people, and 24 people were injured. So, just unlucky. Well, in the 70s, unfortunately, luck wasn't on many of the pilots' side because there was a few more. 1972, a flight was distracted by a faulty landing gear indicator light. They became preoccupied, the crew did. Autopilot disengaged and they crashed into the Everglades, killing 100 people. Who wants to guess what the outcome or the fault was, besides miscommunication? A bulb, light bulb. Turkish Airlines, a cargo door blew out, decompressed the whole plane. It did lead to hypoxia, but it was also really poorly controlled between the plane and air traffic control, and everyone died. Tenerife, you probably know this one. Miscommunication and a bit of fog between ATC and two planes. 583 people died. Finally, a year before Buddy's flight, a United Airlines, the same company, were flying some cargo. They became distracted because a landing gear light didn't light up. Sound familiar? And we can all laugh, but they became so distracted that they literally flew into a mountain. So, 1,000 plus people. 1,000 people died, and the airline industry started thinking, shit, we should do something about this. 1,000 people in a decade. How many people do you think die of preventable deaths? We'll say in the US, because they're the one who keeps figures. Preventable deaths in the US every year. Between 50 and 150,000 people. So a good million over a decade. But the airline industry is a business, a billion-dollar business. I know medical is as well, but if you're sick, you go to hospital, that's all there is to it. Or you call one of us and we come and see you. But as a business, I want to do something about it. So what happened next? United Airlines put cameras in their flight simulators and they started to record their pilots and their flight engineers, everyone, and seeing what was going on. And here's what they found. So not quite that, but very similar. So what did they do? They went to some guys at a little company, and I say guys because it was mostly men back then, sorry, but went to some people at a little company called NASA, and they said, guys, we're, people are dying. What are we going to do? And NASA said, oh, we've got this little thing called crew resource management. They actually called it cockpit resource management back then. And they said, have you thought about doing that? And they said, oh, what is it? Great question. Glad you asked. It's all these buzzwords that teaches people how to communicate better, how to manage problems, threat and error management, things like that. And the airline industry said, fantastic, we'll start teaching our pilots and co-pilots and all that straight away. And NASA said, no idiots, you've got to teach everyone. I said, what do you mean? Everyone. So they did. They taught everyone from the pilots to the mechanics, CEOs, upper lower management, cabin crew, and it stayed like that until today. The flight you guys all came over on, if you did, they all would have been taught this. So, what was the outcome? The outcome was this guy. Who knows that guy? Oh, there we go, more than I thought. For those who don't, you might know him now. What people don't know is that Sully was a CRM, crew resource management facilitator, and he owned a business that taught the concepts to big businesses and management and all that sort of stuff. Sully, while he was flying, he wasn't the pilot in command that day, his co-pilot was, but very quickly he said the magic words the captain says, my aircraft, and the co-pilot says, your aircraft, and then he's in charge. Within 1 second of seeing the birds had hit. They had no chance. They could not go anywhere else. It was shit, bang. Within 30 seconds of the strike, Captain Sully's heard communicating that it's possible he's going to land in the Hudson. Within 30 seconds. The whole thing only took 3.5 minutes from strike to landing. 3.5 minutes. He was once interviewed, there's a couple of really good resources. He was once interviewed and said, did you consider telling your family goodbye over the voice recorder? Just say goodbye, just in case. And he's not an arrogant man, he's a humble man, he's an awesome man. And he said, no, because I was confident in myself and I knew I could land that plane. And now he's been proven that if he had gone anywhere else, he would have killed everyone. So there you go. Cool story. Why are you here? Well, good question. I'm going to be honest. I can't teach you everything I want to, and I heard that last night as well. We don't have time, and that's fine. But what I do want to do is introduce you to a few ideas, and I want your curiosity to be sparked, like mine was. I want you to have an aha moment, and I want you to go away and read about stuff. And that's the more detailed stuff with crew resource management. But in the meantime, I also want to show you something that I've developed. I believe it can be used. It doesn't have to be used exact. It just has a lot of good stuff in it, I think, that might help you become better communicators. You might be guns. I got no idea, but it might. No? Laugh. I don't know. Maybe not guns. I don't know. I have a warning. I hate war stories, and you're going to hear a few. I really do hate war stories. I do. They'll be quick. And there's going to be a lot of buzzwords, so apologies. So here's what I do. A bit like an A to E, as in you go round and round. Discuss, decide, do, and then the most important bit at the end is we do a debrief. But before a debrief, before we discuss anything, we need to look at being a team. Team, we all know, much more effective than the sum of its parts, blah, 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 blah. Team building starts with appropriate leadership. CRM teaches you to exercise your authority in a way that is makes people want to take notice. You could be, and I've said it a lot in the CSP car when new people were coming on, when I was working clinical support, and we'd have new people that had just started. And they were brilliant. They might be the best at ECGs. They might be the best at trauma, best at whatever. I said, it doesn't matter. You could be the best paramedic in Australia. If no one wants you in the back of their truck, what does it matter? If no one wants to play with you, no one's going to hear what you have to say. So you need to be a team player. A team doesn't have to be a huge group of people either. I still see a team as, and I'm trying to make it medical, but I've spent 15 years in AMBO, but I see AMBO and a triage nurse. I see that as a team because you've got a common goal. So a team doesn't have to be us here. A team can be me and Gail from Royal Perth there. Just wanted to point someone out. How? Introductions. Take a breath, smile, even if you're wearing a mask or on a phone. Who else noticed a bit more tension during COVID? And not just because everyone thought in the early days we're all going to die and no one's going to make it to next year. Who else noticed some tensions? I mean, obviously everyone's under the pump, but I think, personally, it was because we couldn't come in and smile. Because smile, you disarm the person. It might be 3 a.m, rock up, triage nurse, they've had a shit night. As an AMBO, triage nurses probably all think that we sleep most of the night, I'm not sure, but sometimes it's true. You don't want to go in there and be an idiot. Just go in there, hey, how are you? Smile. We've got this, but it's nothing important. If you've got something else to do, we're in no rush. Smiles de-escalate the situation. And they make, and wearing a mask made introductions so much more important. With a simple good morning, and just with your tone, you're going to slow everything down. Team leader. Many of us are in the job we are today because we were hired because we could be autonomous. We could think for ourselves, we could act for ourselves, and now I'm asking you to be part of a team. But it doesn't mean you lose all your autonomy. It means that I can't look at the notes because I can't find the mouse. So in team leaders, we've got secure authority versus insecure authority. Secure authority is someone who will use all their resources available to them. No matter who you are, no matter what you are, if you're a PCA, brand new to the job, blah, 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 it doesn't matter. You'll be used and you'll use that person. Insecure is someone who doesn't matter who's what is right, they are just who is right. And we've all come across those people. in all our jobs, we've come across the person who, doesn't matter what you say to them, they don't want to listen because they are right. And I will make the rest up. Flat hierarchy. It is what it sounds like. Use everyone. Doesn't matter who you are. Brand new, being mentored, grad nurse, student nurse, anything. Doesn't matter. You never know what that person knows. I was doing a transfer into our children's hospital quite a while ago, and I was mentoring a new Ambo. But he just spent 5, 6, 7 years as a PCA down at Fiona Stanley, which is another hospital in WA. And so he was shit hot at PCA, but wasn't as shit hot as being an Ambo yet. But we were transferring a kid, unstable cervical, and had this group of doctors and nurses and everyone saying how we should do things. Here's how we should do things, how we should do things. And I just said, Dave, do you have anything to add? And as soon as I gave him that in, he was like, yes, here's what we're going to do. I need you to get this and this and this and this. And he owned it. But he was the right person to use in that situation, but he also needed that leg up, I guess. And that would come into team intelligence and creating that psychological safety. And it's difficult to do in jobs that we have where we're meeting people for the first time every day. It's difficult to have that psychological safety, feel safe to speak up and not be said, oh, yeah, what a jerk. Or as myself and Dylan used to say, DYT, do your time. Sorry, PCA, porter. What else can you?
PSA, water
type thing. PSA?
Patient support. Water.
There you go.
Okay, sure.
Oh, dear.
I thought it was, but I just wanted to talk.
We talk about shared language later on, and I should probably learn that. Let's discuss. How? Brief the problem. Where's Quentin? Quint, can you come find my mouse for me, please? Thanks, man. Brief the problem. So take a breath, if you can. If you've got time, take a breath, think about what you can say before you say it. But in the end, a brief should be brief. Found it? Thanks, man. It's team. See, I used the right person for the job. Brief should be brief. Only say what you need to say, get your point across. And then everyone else, silent cockpit. And that's a theory where only the important stuff should be said. So be quiet, unless you have something important to say. Don't forget also, this is going to be the first time you're going to brief your team. And courage is contagious. So make it sound like you're in control and you're loving life. Ask for solutions. And when I say everyone, I mean everyone. Police, bystanders, family, and that's the PCAs, sorry, wardies, everyone else. And then coming across from that is using a shared language with your team. And that could be, and I know I keep bringing up AMBO stuff, I'm sorry, but if we've got police helping us at a scene with a lift or something, and that patient's tubed or has an IGL in or something, you'd say, watch the breathing tube. Don't say, watch the ETT, because the cops are like, I don't know. I know how to taser someone, but I don't know how to. Also, fireys. If you've got a line in and you want fireys to extricate from a car, that line's coming out. Always have two. So shared language. Make sure you're using shared language. And that, in a hospital environment, if you're doing like a transfer off to a cath lab or something, and you've got wardies and stuff around, just, yeah, use that language that everyone understands. You might have a brand new grad nurse, a brand new student. I had a student doctor ask me what's a VB? Like, but good on him for asking, but I didn't know where he was in his career. Ask for solutions, we've done that, shared language. Risk reward, do the least to achieve the most. Don't get complicated, don't make it complicated. A lot of stuff I do in life is risk reward. Before I came up here, I lost about 10% of my PowerPoint somehow, transferring it from my iPad to Quentin's. And risk reward, I guess, was I may as well just do it. Low risk, high reward. I'll just lie. Exactly. Things to consider. Be clear. Don't just send and acknowledge. And that is IV access at 1755. Copy. What did you copy? What did you hear? So copy IV access 1755, patent. So make sure that person knows that you heard what they said. Otherwise, they'll tell you later, you know, oh, what time did I do it? What did I say then? It's like, I didn't even know you did it. It just ensures they're actually actively listening. Medication administration is a really important one. You know, giving the DAS this much, this time, whatever, copy. And for this reason, I always say giving 10-minute DAS IV for seizures, for, you know, blah, 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 at this time, and then I get that person to read that back to me. Be specific, avoid the hint and hope. Frosty. Frosty was hinting and hoping. And he, oh, no, he didn't die. Oh, did he? One of them died. Don't know which one. But Frosty needed to hint a little bit louder. Or no, he didn't need to hint at all. Say only enough to convey the message. People lose interest, which is why I'm trying to walk around a bit and yell and tell a few jokes, because people lose interest really quickly. So be concise. So let's move on to the next one. Be timely. If you see something, say something. And this is something I'm really passionate about. I don't care who you are, what you do, what you're there for. If you see something, say something. And if no one listens, say stop. Or urgent, but I say stop, because it's hard to, that momentum is hard to slow down. But with a word like stop, people are going to say, oh. I said a simple stop usually works, but I like a stop. Decide. We're going to decide what to do. sorry, it's just a bit back to front. That's okay. All right. Plan A and plan B. Always have a plan C. Sully had his plan C within 30 seconds of hitting those birds. He wanted to land back at the airport he came from. He then wanted to land in his head at Teterboro. But he knew his plan C, he was putting that plane down in the water. So he always had a plan C. If everything else failed, he knew what he was doing. I learnt plan Cs need to be in place dispatching helicopters, because helicopters break down a lot. They get one little red light and the pilots say, we're landing. And they'll land anywhere. Chip light, we're going down. Not going down, going down, but we're landing now. And then if you're suddenly caught off guard, it's like, well, the chopper's not coming anymore. Well, what do we do now? So you need a plan C. Plan C should ultimately be make that patient safe. Try to. While you're deciding, we're going to appoint duties. Using names or really good eye contact in their role. So if you do know someone's name, use it. If you don't, eye contact. If they're doing something like airway, I don't think it's rude if you just say, airway, how are you doing? They know you mean them. I'll come in with someone who's intubated or something. First thing I'll say is, who's airway? Me. Okay, or if I'm not up that end, the first thing I'll say is, who's team lead? Because that then makes, I think, the doctor in charge say, oh, it's me. Okay, we need some direction or we need some guidance. And that seems to work. But appoint duties, use their names. Having name badges really helps. And it also makes that person accountable. Clear transition. Know when you're going to move to plan B and make sure you do it. We've all been there. Oh, just one more chance at cannulating. Just one more. One more. Got the bone gun ready. No, one more. I'll get it. Verbalise. Verbalise everything and ask for confirmation for your team. Ask them to repeat it. If you verbalise something, I'll say myself, cannulation at 17:55. And then I don't write it down, but in a debrief, I'll say, what time did I cannulate? And someone will say, well, 17:55. Or even better, if you've got this team lead, if they're completely hands off and they can scribe for you, which I know happens, and I'm so jealous when it happens in ED, you have a dedicated scribe, and I would hate to be that scribe because I've got terrible writing, but I'm always really jealous. We toyed with ideas. We have, for our resources, we have about 5 people turn up on scene, and we should have an overwatch or a team lead, and that person should be completely hands off. And I toyed around with the idea of bringing a clipboard to give them to say you can't touch anything. And then apparently other people had ideas to take their gloves off because then you feel less like you're going to touch stuff. And I thought it was a good idea. Also, verbalise everything. Talk while you're doing it. You're more likely to progress to plan B if it's a joint decision. If you've got a messy airway and you're like, I'm just suctioning continuously here. Okay, let's move to plan B. Okay. Probably don't feel like you failed enough, but it's not a failure. Things to consider: rely on your team and use them. The breakdown: there will always be a bit of a communication breakdown. People get upset, it's taking too long, whatever. There will be a breakdown and it will hinder progression. If you get people that really don't want to be involved, they'll quietly walk away and do their own thing. In AMBO world, it's the person who says, I'll get extrication, and they're lost, they're out the front. I shouldn't dob in my own kind, should I? Buy-in. It helps if you have a team that believes in the process. And this is something that trying to put this to practice in my world, you get a big group of people, big mix of people who've been around for 30 years, and they're used to working alone. So trying to then get them to make them to show them teamwork is good can be difficult. A leader leads. I've said a lot of fluffy words about let's use your team and let's be a team and let's all hold hands and do all that sort of stuff. But there's a saying, the cockpit is not a democracy. You need a team leader. And that team leader should be taking all the information available to them and then making a decision. And in the end, as a team leader, it is that person's decision. So let's do it. I want to show you something first. One way of doing things. Who's heard of the World Health Safe Surgical Checklist? Yeah? No? Yeah? No? Blows your mind. Read the paper. So doctors from the World Health sought advice, believe it or not, from many sources, including Boeing, the airline industry, because Boeing do checklists better than anyone. They developed this safe surgical checklist. 19 items, takes 2 minutes to complete. In 2007, they rolled it out. You can see all over the place. Some rich, some poor, some good, some bad. They tried to spread it around. The outcomes were astounding. So much so that the authors spent the next year or two trying to disprove themselves because one of the lead doctors said this can't be right. There was a 47% decrease in death and a 36% decrease in major complications. So they had about 4,000 patients. 435 would have been expected to have a serious complication, but just 277 did. Spared 150 people from harm and spared 27 people from death for 2 minutes' work. I'm not saying we will have to use them, it's just something to put out there. So, how? We can use a checklist. We can. There are types of checklists: read, do confirm. So, it has what it, you either read something, you do it, or you see something, you confirm it. That's all there is to it. Examples: we already use checklists. A to E could be one, DOPES, CNS surveys, fast race. They're already there. What else? Anyone? Something I thought, and I don't know if hospitals have this or not, but a checklist for AMBOs going in on P1, things you want to get done or things you need to get done. And for receiving hospitals, things that they should have organised by the time you get there. Time, you know, I always hear like, you know, code coming in at whatever time. But it was like, okay, it's a trauma, so have we paged this guy? Have we done this? And again, I don't know if it happens in every hospital. I asked a couple of nurses, they said no, but that doesn't mean much. Moving a patient with an airway. We're careful about it, but should we be making sure sats are staying above a certain level? Should we make sure the tube hasn't moved? Every single airway, every single time we move, should we do a checklist? Things to consider, and a checklist won't always work. So regardless, whether you're using a checklist, don't forget, communicate, encourage while working through your plan. In aviation, they use go and no-go. Airway, how are you doing? We're a no-go. Okay. You know that they're not going. You're moving a patient to cath lab. We're able to go, we're a no-go. Okay. Then you figure out why. Plans change all the time. Avoid confirmation bias. Confirmation bias. I swear, I had two goes at tubing this guy, and I swear on the third time, I know plan B was after two attempts, but I swear that third time I'm going to get it because I saw the cords. What you don't say is, I saw a lot of blood as well and gunk, and I'm suctioning profusely and it's not working. Confirmation bias, you think you can get it. We've all been there. Dylan knows I've been there. Move to plan B. Do it when agreed upon. Make it a team decision as well, because everyone sees this as some sort of failure and it's not. We got rid of things like the failed intubation drill. It's now a difficult airway trolley and all that sort of stuff, but failed, it's not failed. You're just moving on to your second line, that's all. But if you make it a team effort, like, oh, everyone, you know, we said we'd move to plan B at this time, let's do it. Yep, let's do it. And then the person who's struggling is like, okay, let's just try for an IGL first. Or let's cut a hole in the neck, I don't know. Plan C isn't a failure, as I've already said. Plan C should be just making that patient as safe as possible, and then guess what? We can start again. We can start discussing. So here's our patient. We've tried this, this, and this. That's not working. Start the process again. So, does it work? You tell me. How long do we have? How long has it been? 42 minutes. I wanted to show you the voice record for Sully. Does everyone want to listen? Oh, it gives me chills, I tell you.
Every day.
My aircraft, your aircraft.
Check this 15.9 thermal thing 270.
Cactus 1539 in Bird Suit, Bronx Road, no problem. Interjecting by ports avoided.
Okay, you need to return a little while. Turn left heading up at 220.
Plan A, and he's confirming what he heard.
Sir, stop your departure, he's got emergency returning. What is it? 1529, he third strike, he lost all engines, he lost the thrust in the engines due to turning the engine.
Cactus 1529, which engines?
He lost thrust in both engines, he said.
Got it.
At 1529, could you get it, Steve? Do you want to try to land 1813?
1813 will point me into the lesson.
He's already voiced it.
Charlie 27, take you from 07 there.
They're going through checklists.
All right, back at 1529, could be less traffic to runway 31.
Unable.
Okay, what do you need to land?
Cactus
Have you 15.9 runway 4 is available if you want to be left after runway 4. Okay, you're on your right side and see the Royal Airport.
Plan B.
Do you want to try to go to Tierra?
Yes.
Tierra, Empire. Actually, we're going to park Sky Mercy in that. Thank you. Captain 15.9 over the George Washington Bridge wants to go to your airport right now.
Well, sir, how do I check? Does he need assistance?
Yes, the bird strike. Can I get him in for runway 1?
Runway 1, that's good.
Captain 15.9, turn right 280 and you land for runway 1 at Tierra.
We can't do it.
Okay, which runway would you like at Tierra?
We're going to be home.
I'm sorry, say it again, Captain.
While he's trying to land, all these are automated warnings.
Cactus 15.9 radar contact is low. You hopefully got Newark Airport up to 2 o'clock in about 7 miles.
At that point, so after he said we'll be in the Hudson, he cut off communication with air traffic control because it was not going to do him any more good.
5.7 18 0 10 2 1 0.
We'll just... Just keep looking here. You got any ideas?
Right to the end. Okay, 2 o'clock
in 7 hours.
Any 5.718, I'm sorry, I missed that second.
And we're up to 12,000 new units.
Okay, thank you. 5.718, tell us 220.
220, plus 72.
So, that showed obviously pretty awesome communication, especially the second one, talking to Teterboro. They do really good confirming speech. So, he asked, he delivered, but also read it back to him. Runway 1, check. He knew. As I've already said, Sully knew he was going to be able to do that. Well, was somewhat newer, and he did it. And then I've read his autobiography, and depends how much you like that, but especially the section on him landing, it's awesome. So I'll go through quickly because we're at 47. Debrief? Yeah, okay, quick. So the most important part, we're going to take in 1 second, or 3 seconds. Debrief. How? Stop. Summarise. Things that went well. Opportunities improved. Points take action. I'm a huge fan of debrief. Every person, and you don't always bring people around. I'm such a big debriefer. When I was back in the day, I would have said debriefs are lame, but I love a debrief and you learn so much. Things to consider, the boring stuff really, but fatigue, 18 hours, 0.05, 23 hours, 0.12, diet, you spend 120 calories an hour, high workload. Oh, and I haven't got a... Oh, that's what you're doing. I thought you'd give me the this. No, you give me the this. Sorry. Can you not hear me? I'm a loud speaker. Personal life. Is something happening? Something that's quite important is in the aviation industry, if something's wrong, if you haven't had a good sleep, something like that, the first thing you do when you do your crew debrief, and that will be with the pilot, crew member, the flight crew, things like that. Someone will say, look, I went for 8 hours sleep today, but I'm pretty sure I had about 5 or 6. So just FYI. And that it's not like a you can't fly. It's a no worries. If I notice something, I'm going to take over. It's just making that person aware. That's all it is. Making that person aware that you might be more likely to make a mistake. But if they don't know, they don't know. Am I wrapping up? I just want to tell you a very quick story that put me in my place. I was doing an airway cadaver course, an airway course at UWA, University of Western Australia. And so it's bizarre because a bunch of cadavers, obviously. And then we had 6 of them, and you just go around and you practice different types of intubation, chest drain, things like that. And some of them were just heads, so it was a little bit weird. But
I digress. It was all with the, we did it with the critical care paramedics, the helicopter paramedics. And there's one certain helicopter paramedic who is a man, he's a South African dude, and it's standing here, and he was on the floor, he'd probably still, and this guy is, he used to play rugby, and I would run the other way if I was holding the ball. He's massive. There's often jokes about them having to use yet less fuel when Clinton's on, but he wouldn't care me using his name because he made me look like an idiot. So, I was doing this cadaver course with him, and we're all joking around, and I made a joke about Clinton getting downtime because Chopper doesn't do that much work, but when they do work, they're RSIing, it's a single operator on the WA HEMS, Crit Care Chopper. So they're doing an RSI by themselves with like a crewman who's basically trained. So it's big time. And I said, yeah, blah, 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 Clinton, well, you know, you get lots of sleep, beauty sleep, blah, blah, blah. And he looked at me with these big, big eyes. And he said, Drew. And I was like, fuck. Shit. Drew, God forbid, if I ever come to one of your family members that has wrapped their car around a tree down in Margaret River somewhere and I've got an RSI him, you better hope to God that I've had 8 hours sleep. And I looked at him and I said, I can't argue with that. That's it. That done. He owned me. And it's true. We need sleep. We need sleep. And it's something as all of us, we don't do well. We go to work tired. Aviation, it just doesn't happen. You fly too much, you don't fly anymore. Here, I'm on holidays and I'm getting texts about doing overtime. No one cares. You got to look after yourself. Oops, can I go back one? Just a bit of a wrap up. There's also a YouTube video called Sully Unfiltered. It's like a 12-minute clip. It's really, really good. Beyond the checklist is, if you like this sort of shit, it's amazing. The checklist, that was the one who, that's about the World Health Organization checklist and how it came about. Sully, obviously, it's a bit dry sometimes, but that's a good story. And this one I read many, many, many years ago. It's a Canadian dude who wanted to be an astronaut and he did everything he could to get there. And obviously not a lot of Canadians end up in NASA, but yeah, really good. All I can say to finish on, first of all, thanks for having me, but second, just remember our jobs can be shit and tough and horrible. They can also be good, but I try and remind people that at the very least, we get perspective that no one else gets. We understand sometimes on a daily basis that life ends abruptly. And we forget that. So do things like this, go on holidays, spend 5 weeks driving around New Zealand with your sister. Just do it, because I don't want to say you might be dead tomorrow, but you just never know. Also, just be curious, ask questions. And in an environment like this, just stay humble. All right, that's enough, thank you.
And nothing like talking about plane crashes just before we're at your planes tomorrow. So we might have a look at that timetable for next time. Let's take a real quick break and then we're back with Hayley and Vivenne, that's going to bring it home for the week. So eat up and we'll see you back in your chairs shortly.
Good job.
Say Taylor was a good girl, never want to be late, complain, express ideas in her brain. Working on the night shift, best another day, kids are gonna have to pay her if you wanna park here. Well, mommy's little dancer is quite a little secret, walking on the streets now, never gonna keep it. I intuition, and now she's only wishing that she would have listened to the words they said. She just wanders around, unaffected by the winter wind, yeah. She'll pretend that she's somewhere else, so far and clear, about 2,000 miles. On the window, the sun is silhouette. Poor old Pete's got nothing, cause he's been fouling. Somehow, someone knows just where he's been. He thinks the singing on Sunday gonna save his soul. Now that Saturday's gone. Sometimes he thinks that he's on his way, but I can see that his brake lights are gone. And he just wanders around, unaffected by the winter winds, yeah. And he'll pretend that, well, he's somewhere else, so far away. About 2,000 miles from here. Such a duff in gelato, filled up with nada. Giving what you gotta give to get a dollar bill. Used to be in the chicken, times have been a tick. Now no, she's got the lick into the man. The money in his pocket, yeah, flying in his rocket, only stopping by on his way to a better world. Do you think he finds a better world?
our sunshine in a bag. I'm useless, but not for long. The future is coming on. I ain't happy, I'm feeling glad. I got sunshine in a bag. I'm useless, but not for long. The future is coming on. It's coming on. It's coming on. It's coming on. It's
finally, someone let me out of my cage. Now, time for me is nothing, cause I'm counting no A's. Nah, I couldn't be there. Nah, you shouldn't be scared. I'm good at repairs, and I'm under each snare. Intangible, bet you didn't think, so I command you to panoramic view. Look, I'll make it all manageable. Pick and choose, sit and lose, all you different crews. Chicks and dudes, who you think is really kicking tunes. Picture you getting down in a picture tube, like you lit the fuse. You think it's fictional, mystical, maybe. Spiritual hero who appears in you to clear your view, yeah. When you're too crazy, lifeless. To those the definition for what life is, priceless to you because I put you on the hype shit. You like it? Gun smoke, you're righteous with one toke. You're psychic among no possess you with one go.
I'm feeling glad I got sunshine in a bag. I'm useless, not for long. The future is coming on. I'm feeling glad I got sunshine in a bag. I'm useless, but not for long. The future is coming on. It's coming on. It's coming on. It's coming on. It's coming on.
The essence, the basics. Without it, you make it. Allow me to make this childlike in nature. Rhythm, you have it or you don't. That's a fallacy. I'm in them. Every sprouting tree, every child of peace, every cloud and sea. You see with your eyes and see destruction and demise. Corruption in the skies from this fucking enterprise. Now I'm sucked into your lies through rust. So not in muscles, but percussion you provide for me as a guide. Y'all can see me now cause you don't see with your eye. You perceive with your mind, that's the inner. So I'ma stick around with rust and be a mentor. Bust a few rhymes so motherfuckers remember what the thought is. I brought all this so you can survive when law is lawless, right. Feeling sensations that you thought was dead. No squealing, remember
that is all in your head.
I ain't happy.
Okay, everyone, it's time for our final photo competition. So we still have a few vouchers to give away. These ones are thanks to Emergency Fit, and we also have a hat from Righto Heroes. So a few things there still to win. Also, if anyone wants I think there's some balaclavas, neck warmers from the Coronet and Remarkables, the maps, please come see Dylan and myself. We have a number of them still there that we're not keen to take back to Perth with us. So come see us at the back there. We'll be very happy to pass some of those on. Let's start the video. Alright, nice one there. Let's now go through some video. Nice. That's actually a very artistic photo. I'm impressed. Oh, Lord of the Ring fan. Oh, he doesn't get old. Oh, no. Oh. Once again, I think less laughing for these ones. Oh, it's top of Skyline. Can we all see the hand in the mouth? What do you reckon? Bungee jumping?
Yeah.
All right, bungee jumping, and I reckon if someone got their hand almost bitten off by whatever beast of a cow that thing is, they also deserve a prize. So come see Dylan after, and we'll get you guys sorted. So, pretty much finish the conference off, we have both Vivenne and Hayley here, and they're going to be talking all about Victorian Virtual Emergency Department. So coming up, we're all excited to hear it, so let's hear a nice big round of applause.
Okay, hello everyone, thank you for coming along to the last session today.
My name's Vivenne King and I'm one of 9 associate nurse unit managers at the Victorian Virtual Emergency Department. And this is Hayley Gray, who is our nurse unit manager. Hayley and I have worked closely over the last 6 years together in the emergency department, at the COVID immunisation hub, and now at the Victorian Virtual Emergency Department. Hayley, can you tell us what to expect from our presentation today?
So today we're going to explain the virtual ED all the way from the evolution to where we are today. So providing some data and stats, and we'll hear from some of our key clinicians and external stakeholders. We'll talk about our workforce, the challenges and how we've overcome those. We'll demonstrate the patient journey throughout the virtual ED and our future plans.
Great. Hayley, can you share with everyone who we are and what we do?
So we are the Victorian Virtual Emergency Department. We're a free 24/7 statewide service to everyone within Victoria. So for anyone suffering a non-life-threatening emergency, they're able to register for a video consultation with our registered nurses, doctors and nurse practitioners. And it's, as I said, available to all Victorians who are able to self-register and also register through healthcare professional pathway. The best person to explain about all the VVED is our VVED director, Dr. Lauren Scher.
Fantastic. So in 2020, COVID-19 came to our shores and VVED was the initiative out of that. I remember the VVED, which was then called Virtual Triage, as a really small team working upstairs in the Northern Health Emergency Department.
So yeah, when it first began, we had one registered nurse and one doctor operating from within the physical ED. It was just an 8-hour shift each day. Let's hear from one of our original nurses, Natalie, about those early days of virtual ED.
So it originally started at the top of the Northern Health ED department. It was a very small office that was just committed to the triage nurse and the consultant, and we have a shared desk. Basically, the triage nurse would assess the patient, and if the consultant deemed the patient appropriate to come in, then we'll need to come in, and the triage nurse would become their primary nurse. I really enjoyed the change, especially because the role that I was doing would be very good time, so it's good to get off the floor and away from the chaos. So I really enjoyed the diversity of the role, being clinical but not so much on the floor. It's been great to see that our departments are going from like a shared space with consultants to now having soundproof pods and ever-growing staff. So it's been really good.
Great. So we'll talk to you about the pathways of how you can access VVED. We've got two pathways. We've got the self-registration pathway. So that's for people in the community. What they do is they jump online to vved.org.au. From that, they fill out a registration form. That gives them a link to their mobile phone or to their device. With their link, they drop into a nurse-manned waiting room. So there, they'll see the triage nurse. The nurse will go through their assessment with them. And from that, they will decide on the patient's disposition based on that assessment and that acuity. So the nurse is able to refer into the emergency department. They're able to decide if that patient needs an urgent video consult and refer over to our clinicians, or provide that nursing care advice and a management plan. But best of all, they can link those patients in back with community care services. Hayley, tell us a bit more about that nurse role.
So our registered nurses conduct a triage similar to that of a physical ED, but in our virtual space. So we have 4 categories for our triaging. So category ones are requiring urgent review within emergency departments. Category twos and threes are both seen within the VVED by our medical team. Category twos are seen within 10 minutes and category threes in less than an hour. And category fours are managed entirely by the nurse. So the nurse can provide nursing care and advice and management, and also link back in with community services such as respiratory clinics, general practitioners, and our priority primary care centres that we've got throughout the state.
Great, so this is what is considered our non-life-threatening emergencies. I'm not sure if you guys can read that from there. Is that clear enough? Yep, perfect, excellent. So everyone who does register for VVED though will be assessed via that self-registration pathway. And as we all know, that our patients don't necessarily understand their acuity, and that's from the well to the very unwell. We've got a case study here of an 18-month-old girl whose parents wanted a further opinion from their GP, who had diagnosed their child with having had a cold. They weren't sure if the child was getting better, getting worse, not sure. So they signed up for virtual ED, and in the chief complaint, they wrote something along the lines of uncontrolled fever for 5 days, lethargic, cold hands and feet. So that's a big red flag for all of us. So we were able to pull that patient straight out of the waiting room over to a paediatrician who got urgent lights and sirens ambulance to them. They were taken to Monash Children's, where she was intubated for invasive group strep A. She did make a remarkable recovery, so that was thanks to that early intervention of VVED and the amazing team at Monash Children's.
So for our self-registrations, they account for 60% of our registrations to VVED each day. So category ones, 2%, those are sent into the emergency department, which is recognised by the nurse of their higher acuity. Category twos and threes are both seen within the virtual ED for a video consult with our medical team. And category fours account for 19%, so those ones are managed entirely by our nursing staff.
Fantastic. Back to the AV healthcare practitioner pathway. That what happens there is the paramedic actually decides on scene that patient is suitable for a direct video consult. After they have a successful registration, and what that means is that they don't hit any of those red flag criterias, they're sent a link directly to their phone. They will drop into a clinician-manned waiting room where they'll bypass that triage nurse and they can have that clinician-to-clinician handover. That's where an assessment and the consult occurs, and then a management plan happens. It's been a really strong partnership for us with AV. So, Hayley, are you able to talk a little bit more about that partnership?
Yes. Is that on? Perfect. So in October 2021, the Ambulance Victoria and VVED partnership was formed. This was really to support one another with those low acuity patients, but still being able to provide that care that those patients did require. Let's hear from one of our very avid VVED users, paramedic Pete, to tell us all about his experience with the VVED.
The VVED is proving to be an incredible resource for on-road paramedics. The technology provides us the ability to easily liaise with the VVED doctors for advice, management and referrals. Many times we find ourselves with patients that are not requiring emergency care but do need a doctor review. The VVED supports Ambulance Victoria to safely manage these low acuity call-outs and safely meeting the patients to ensure they do receive appropriate care. Recently I attended a 45-year-old female with gastro-like symptoms. With the VVED doctor support, we were able to use IV fluids and antiemetic, and with the patient being treated at home and referred to her LMO. The consultation with the VVED doctor ultimately saved us an enormous amount of time before we would have otherwise been transported to hospital. This keeps us more readily available to attend those emergency call-outs. This is just one of the many successful outcomes of working closely with the VVED to provide best patient outcomes for the community.
Fantastic. Okay. Let's have a look at some data. Hayley, how many patients has VVED seen all up so far?
So of all registrations, we've seen almost 150,000 to date.
Great, and how many of those registrations have been from Ambulance Victoria or AV?
So 30% of our registrations each day are from Ambulance Victoria. So that's about almost 38,000 AV registrations to date.
Right, and how many of these registrations or patients have we been able to keep home?
So 81% of the registrations from Ambulance Victoria have been able to be managed without being transferred to an emergency department. This translates to 32,000 ambulances that have been able to return to the road and be available for emergencies.
It's pretty significant. Okay, looking back at our timeline now, December 2021, VVED had outgrown its space and Northern Health had supported VVED to become a standalone department. Hayley, you joined NUM in January 2022. Can you tell us what you found in that space then?
So as a result of the success of the original pilot of the virtual triage, we quickly outgrew ourselves and really needed to expand from that 8-hour shift to roll out to a 24/7 model. So we increased our staffing model with doctors operating from 8 a.m. to 11:30 p.m. with specialised nurse practitioners covering the night shift, where we now have medical staff 24/7 also. In February 2022, we received state government funding to become a standalone department and provide a virtual ED service to the entire state of Victoria. So as you can see here, this is our state wide footprint, and we had to roll this out to the state in a phased approach to really build those relationships with each health service across the state to really understand what they required and how we as virtual ED could support them to understand one another's capabilities and also each other's limitations.
Great. As VVED grew, so did that staffing requirement. When I first came to VVED, there was only the emergency trained critical care nurses who were employed to triage. Hayley, how did you overcome the recruitment in a national nursing workforce shortage while trying to inspire nurses to leave the bedside and join a new digital healthcare initiative?
So it was very important for me to view my future workforce as a workforce that was not afraid of change, that was highly adaptable and can problem solve and act upon challenges. It was imperative that I invest in a team that was adaptable and embraces cultural transformation. And as you mentioned, there was and there still is a national nursing workforce shortage. So it quickly became apparent that future recruitment was in the value of our experienced registered nurses. We'd exhausted all our critical care nurses within our region and had to start thinking outside. So we implemented our work from home capabilities to ensure that we were able to hire nurses from all across the state. Viv, you're an experienced nurse. What made you want to dip your toes in the world of digital health?
Well, I'm an ED nurse by trade, so I love a challenge. And I saw VVED as a really exciting new challenge. I sat at triage for many hours, like many of you guys, amazed at the differing ends of that health literacy spectrum that our community sat at. From the really unwell, high-risk walk-in chest pains, which are pads on, direct to resus, direct to cath lab, to the, well, I stubbed my toe 2 weeks ago, I'm not sure what's happening, can someone look at it? So for me, this was an opportunity to raise the community's health literacy, to empower patients to care for themselves, provide equity and access to those in our rural and regional communities where we know that there is a healthcare crisis, all while using the technology that almost everyone has, mobile phone, laptop, tablet. It was a really interesting department when I first came on board in those initial phases. And Hayley, you were the nurse unit manager, but you're also trying to lead the shift from shift to shift. Can you tell us how that went?
So at the beginning, yes, it was a bit of a challenge, and as a new and growing department and service to the state. So as with all new projects, we kind of had to learn a few things on the run, but we did recognise there was that shift leader deficit, which created multiple challenges. We identified the need to model our workspace of that, similar to that of a physical ED. We identified that workload and department flow constraints without the shift lead, which all escalations in the beginning came to myself. Therefore, we implemented the role of the associate nurse unit manager. We were able to employ 9 extremely adaptable and capable ANUMs. Let's hear from Kathy, who's one of our VVED ANUMs, who joined us in last August.
What an amazing opportunity it would be to be part of such an innovative change in healthcare, being a part of a service that's able to help decrease the demand on emergency departments, at the same time increasing health literacy of Victorians. So as an Associate Nurse Unit Manager at VVED, I work alongside an amazing team of nurses, nurse practitioners, doctors and clerical staff. My role as an A&M encompasses a variety of responsibilities. Each shift we provide full oversight and management of patient flow. We run multiple nursing and medical huddles during the shift to disseminate information. And because we are virtual, these huddles also provide a nice opportunity for us to get to see each other and have a little chat. The A&Rs are one of the main points of contact for staff, as well as patients and other healthcare professionals, such as paramedics, aged care facilities, and so forth. We also manage staffing, ensuring that we have adequate provision of resources each shift. One thing that I really enjoy about being A&R is being a clinical resource to the nurses, so assisting them with their consults when needed. We also run educational in-services for nursing staff, and we each lead a quality and safety standard portfolio. It's been an incredible year for me, growing the A&R role and getting to work with such an amazing team. I can't wait to see what's to come for VBED.
Cathy, she's fantastic. She's a great asset to our team and a wonderful asset to the nursing profession. Cathy came across to Virtual ED after we had a move to a purpose built building. Hayley, can you tell everyone a little bit more about that space?
So we moved to our new purpose-built space that was fit out for all our virtual requirements. So as you can see here, we've got soundproof pods. So when the staff are working on site, all the video consults are conducted in here. They are soundproof, they are private and confidential, no longer having to wear our headsets and having to compete for noise space. It was around this time also that we reached our milestone of seeing 100,000 patients.
100,000 patients, that was really big for us, and so was the new move. I just want to go back to our registration portals. We spoke about self-registration and about AV, but we also have healthcare practitioners who access our service. Hayley, can you tell us a bit more who this includes?
So our healthcare professional pathway also includes our urgent care centres, general practitioners, AV triage services, and residential aged care facilities. All these health services are able to register their patients and residents for the VVED, providing that access to medical support to save those unnecessary transfers, but still receiving that care that they require. So we have quite a diverse medical workforce to manage the many different cohorts and of patients and presentations that we see. The best person to explain the medical workforce is the VBED Director of Medical Workforce, Dr. Jason Nebs.
Kia ora koutou, my name is Jason Nebs. I'm an emergency physician here at Victorian Virtual ED. It's a very diverse workforce that we have in Victorian Virtual ED. We have a mix of many clinicians. We've got emergency physicians, we've got pediatric emergency physicians, we have pediatricians, we have GPs, we have GP, ED, pediatric registrar. We have nurse practitioners with a variety of specialty and general experience, including pediatric nurse practice, aged care, palliative care specialist nurse practice, as well as general nurse practitioners as well. So yes, it's a very diverse workforce that we have, providing clinical cover for patients of health.
Fantastic. We also have the early treatment team at VVED.
So that's another of the VVED. We have the VVET, which is the Victorian Virtual Early Treatments Team, and they provide a detailed and nuanced service for antiviral prescribing for COVID-positive patients with Victoria. We have a group of clinicians that perform those consults, including nurse practice, some GPs and some specialist emergency physicians as well, supported by Alex Brown, who's our pharmacist, who is a dedicated resource for VBED and the VBET. So that's a nuanced service that we provide, and with the decreasing ability of the community to actually access some of the antiviral services within the state at the moment, the VBET is providing a statewide service for Victoria at the moment.
Great. And VVED also supports the state's urgent care centres.
That is an increasing body of work that we're seeing at the moment. We have a large and increasing number of urgent care centres that are seeking help from the VVED to cover regional and rural group officials, especially with medical support and nurse practitioner cover. So our numbers of urgent care patients through virtual ED in the last 3 or 4 months especially has increased dramatically. We're seeing large numbers of nursing staff from the regional and rural urgent cares calling in to register their patients with virtual so that we can provide them some medical support or anything from pediatric patients with group through to aged care, falls, query fractures, and shortness of breath, chest pain, etc. And we try and provide as nuanced service and support to those nursing staff and those regional patients to the best of our ability.
So just some data regarding our urgent care centres. So they account for 8% of our registrations to the virtual ED each day. So we've almost supported 5,000 to date. And 76% of these registrations to the VVED are able to be managed with the support of the VVED. So this meaning that 76% of those patients ultimately didn't require transfer to those larger health facilities and able to remain within their potentially local area to receive that care.
Great. Another area where VVED is having a positive impact is with residential aged care facilities. So nursing staff at these facilities are able to register via that AV healthcare practitioner pathway for real-time medical care for their residents. Dr. Alan Jardin is a GP at VVED and he champions this space. So let's hear from Alan.
At the Victorian Virtual Emergency Department, we try to keep patients at home in their aged care facility when it's safe and appropriate to do so. In order to make these decisions, we take into account a number of factors, including the acute presentation, medical comorbidities, and the wishes of the patient and their family members. There's been numerous occasions in which the Virtual Emergency Department has had a positive impact on the care of the patients in the aged care setting. One example that I can share with you is it took place just the other night. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. We had a call from a concerned nurse at the aged care facility. She had an 89-year-old lady who had become quite short of breath over the course of the evening. Upon assessment, it was clear that this patient was approaching the end of life, and rapidly so. I was able to make contact with the patient's family and medical recovery attorney. I explained to them the situation and that the mother was rapidly approaching the end of life, and we talked through the options. Keeping her at home, comfortable with the use of appropriate medications, or transferring her to hospital for further investigation and management there. The family were quick to come to the conclusion that their mother would rather stay at home, where she was known to her facility, where she was comfortable, and where they would hopefully be able to attend to the earth bedside. Once this decision had been made, they were able to initiate the appropriate palliative care medications, and her family were able to be at her bedside when she passed away later that morning. This is just one of many examples of where the Virtual Emergency Department has been able to have a meaningful impact in the aged care setting.
So just some residential aged care facility data. So they account for 7% of our registrations each day. Each of these presentations to the virtual ED are linked back in with the residential inreach within their area to ensure that they receive follow-up. 72% of these residents are able to be supported with VVED to remain and receive the care in their homes. So the VVED, as Alan just said, is able to provide palliative care management and commence palliative care measures with specialised aged and palliative care staff within the VVED. We also identified at-risk populations, which included our over 65-year-olds and our First Nations community. We identified that these cohorts have lower engagement rate in healthcare and follow-up plans. We implemented post-consult reviews within 24 hours to mitigate this, so any presentations of these populations receive a follow-up call. In recent times, we've also implemented a review clinic for our high-risk patients, whereby patients that are suitable are followed up by the VVED, booked into an appointment. So reviews such as X-ray reviews, pediatric fluid reviews, and results-related reviews.
We're finding the feedback from the review clinic, it brings a sense of care resolution and joy to a lot of these patients. Speaking of joy, let me take you to Christmas 2022. What an absolute roller coaster that was. We went from seeing 300 patients a day to overnight seeing 600 patients. So let me tell you, the quote, culture wins championships, rang true for our team. Here's a bit of a silly video which was done for an organisational competition that we thought we'd share with you.
Anyway,
there was a bit more, but you might all go deaf because that was very loud.
We did not expect our presentations to double overnight, but with Northern Health support, we were able to be flexible and adaptable to meet the service demand. This allowed us to instantly act on the challenges and once again to transform the way that the VVAD operates in this patient-led space. It was a challenge, but a challenge that we met. The entire team embraced the challenges and changes that we implemented on the run.
And speaking of challenges, one that we can't deny is IT reliability. It's really important that our systems remain available, capable and responsive. And because of this, we have a close working relationship with Northern Health IT and our vendors, the clinician who run our registration portal and Health Direct, who are our state mandated video interface service. But it's not all clinician and user IT problems, it's also patient end. So does the patient have the IT literacy to access their own settings, to enable their settings for speaker, microphone and camera? What's their internet connectivity like? Because we know out in those rural and regional areas, it's not great. But our team has become adept in talking our patients through these challenges and we try and overcome that. So let's see how this all works from a patient's point of view.
This is a summary on how patients can complete a self-registration for the Victorian Virtual Emergency Department. There are two ways to access the registration form. Patients can visit our website, vved.org.au, or can scan the QR code on one of our magnets.
Oh.
The laptop's dead.
Okay.
So it's really straightforward and it prompts you the whole the way through. So the form is actually able to be translated into 20 different languages and you're able to also request an interpreter throughout the registration process. A recent project we also launched has been the virtual liaison nurse role.
Yes.
And Abby was going to tell us about that one.
I'll tell you about that one. It was actually born out of last year's conference at Seminyak. Myself, being a VVED person and who is now the ED num, we're getting together poolside talking about how the two departments can work collaboratively to divert those low acuity patients into the VVED service. So that's what we've done. There's basically a nurse there that works through triage and pulls patients from triage into our service, obviously with the patient's permission. So that VLN, we're preventing long wait times, decrease the overuse of a critical healthcare system, we're improving patient outcomes and experience, but best of all, we're providing that opportunistic healthcare education. So then the next time that they think, oh, I need to go to ED for XYZ, instead they can start with that simple care advice. So then by the time they get to triage things, okay, well, you've done this, this and this, tick, we'll go through and help you out in ED.
Perfect, thanks, Viv. So from some data for where we are now. So at the moment, we're seeing on average 400 patients per day. 35% of our registrations are paediatrics. Registrations are made up of 60% are self-registrations and 40% are from healthcare professionals. And 85% of overall all presentations are able to be managed and not transferred to the emergency departments.
Lauren.
Let's hear from Lauren about our future plans for the VVED.
So for me, the future vision is, I guess, the virtual hospital space. I really want us to diversify and not be
from just virtual ED and deliver that specialty healthcare to those areas of need. Didn't have to necessarily be in the sort of extremely huge facility space.
Worldwide. I'm not sure how we'll navigate that, but like anything emergency and anything in VVED, we'll give it a good crack.
So the virtual ED to date has proven its success as evidenced by the data, but also by our positive patient feedback. These testaments prove that the service is a success amongst the community and a direct reflection of the project, the team and the commitment of all stakeholders. We and Northern Health are very proud to be growing the VVED. Thank you all for having us today, and if you have any questions, we'll see you at Wellbar.
Thank you very much, both. I think another round of applause for putting up with a technical...
That's all right, we got over it. That's what we do best.
So that does bring a close to the conference, guys. Like all good things, it must come to an end. Before we do sort of release you all, I'll just quickly... Oh, yeah, I'll be telling anyone else to use the microphone, I probably should. Before we do, head off for the night, I just want to remind everyone, 8 o'clock at Wellbar. If you've got your lanyards, that will make entry really, really nice and quick. Maybe think about where you put your jackets. Every year we have plenty of jackets left behind, and I usually have pick of the bunch. But almost every year as well, we have passports left in those jackets. So just be really mindful of that, and maybe have a plan B and C as to how you're going to get home. Dylan and I really just want to thank each and every one of you for being part of this conference. It means heaps that you guys are all here. We love seeing you enjoying yourselves, and by having people from all over Australia, you get these awesome ideas in terms of whether it's what's going on in Victoria, Queensland, WA. So if you do have any suggestions, any ways that you'd like us to change things up, any suggestions of future destinations, there will be an email going out tomorrow morning. It's already been scheduled, so I don't have to worry about it, which is great. But there is a little quick link there just for a 2 to 3 minute survey. So if you could all just take the time to do that while you're waiting at the airport, that would be much appreciated. And then the final one is also, we've almost reached our target of donating $9,000 to Beyond Blue this year. So thanks to every one of you guys, a portion of the registrations go to that. And from this event, we've got almost $3,300. So round of applause to you guys. If anyone has any questions, wants to re-watch any of the presentations or look at any of the handouts or links that have been mentioned throughout the week, please check out the website. And apart from that, thank you once again and look forward to partying with you all tonight. Cheers.